Hello and welcome to Off the Cuff, or OTC as we call it in short form. Our guest this week is somebody who's so hyperactive that sometimes it becomes difficult for us journalists in Delhi to keep pace with him. And I know that many people say he claims this, he claims that, but the fact is, as yet, I haven't had data to question his claims. But I have also in the audience many people who will know better than me. So, Piyush, welcome to Off the Cuff. You have a great audience. I know with you coming here, we had to do nothing.
Great opportunity to meet a lot of my Mumbai friends.
So, Piyush, before we come to your portfolio and your and what you've done with Power, your first experience in government. You come from a political family. In fact, many people in Delhi didn't realize, I'm sure in Bombay everybody knows, that your father was also a cabinet minister for shipping. How was the government different from what you had imagined hearing about it at home?
Actually, I think it was much, much better than what I had ever imagined. Typically, in our private lives, we were so used to government being an inefficient animal and people in government being lazy, being corrupt, not really delivering on results or performance. My own experience at the end of nearly 2 years now is that it's a wonderful organization to work with. The people working in government have a lot of passion for the country and a lot of desire to do good for the country, for the people of India. What they always lacked was possibly vision and leadership. And I'm on record on several occasions to talk about the public sector versus private sector. And I always believed, even before I went into government, that it was not the ownership which defined the success of an organization. It was always what vision you gave it and the kind of leadership, the kind of empowerment. And I personally am an extremely satisfied person, having spent 2 years now in government, with a whole team which is working literally with a mission, with a zeal to deliver results.
So your leader, the Prime Minister, does he let ministers function or does he micromanage them?
You know, the sad part is the impression versus reality, or as one of your channels where you're often seen says, truth versus hype, is that he has never in 2 years told me once that Piyush, do this or do that, or do this like this or do it the other way. It's a complete empowerment. So I can decide what I want to do, how I want to do, and should I choose to go and bounce off an idea or discuss something with him, he's available 24/7. So if at all, when I was finalizing the coal block auctions, I requested him that I'd like to have a little more detailed presentation made to you and the finance minister. Readily and spontaneously, you get time whenever you want it. An outstanding listener, which is great for me because I'm too much of a talker. So he listens. If you were to judge his time, it's 95% listening, 5% talking. But in that listening, he comes up with nuggets. So I remember when the commercial coal mining decision was to be taken, I was really scared. I was not willing to open up commercial coal mining, much as a lot of people give me credit for opening it up. The reality is I was not game for it. And the Prime Minister and the Finance Minister said, this is the opportunity, we must open it up. But he had the conviction, the courage of conviction, that abhi hoga, abhi kar sakte hain, abhi karna hai. And that's the kind of empowerment we get with his leadership.
So, I'm asking you trick questions, so you don't have to be constantly looking over your shoulder.
For the people of India, for ensuring that I don't do anything wrong. I don't do anything where the Prime Minister tomorrow has to cut a sorry figure for my actions.
But he's not talking to your secretary directly or...
This is another misnomer that many people have. See, Mr. Modi is a great learner. After all, he's just come into Delhi first time. Probably the first time a chief minister has come into government in Delhi as prime minister. Now, he is a great learner. He wants to know the 80 departments in government of India, what's happening. Now, he can't ask each one of us to come and keep reporting what goes on in a department. That all the secretary's job, that they have to go appraise him of the big picture, what's happening in the government of India. Other than that, if he has to give any guidance, even to the secretary, I think that's a great welcome thing.
Have you ever been admonished by him?
Oh, every day. Every cabinet meeting, you know, in some interaction the other day, I don't recall who asked me who talks the most in the cabinet and who gets the most flack. And I remember in that conversation saying that the person who talks the most is my colleague, Shri Nitin Gadkari, because he comes up with some fantastic gems. Understanding business, he can really add a lot of value to whatever
decisions. And you get the flag.
I get the flag because of talking too much.
But it's all good-hearted.
Oh, yeah.
But have you had a serious admonition over something? That why are you doing this? Don't do this. A misunderstanding, which you clarified.
I don't recall really. But I tell you, every time he gives flag, I learn something new. And I welcome it. So, in fact, for all of your audience also, if the Prime Minister is angry about something or he gives you the flag, bear in mind that his intention is only to help you do better, help you do some good. So it's not out of any dvesh or any ill will.
Right.
He genuinely believes that if he comes to know, if he feels something could be done better, let's be upfront about it. You don't have to talk about it behind somebody's back.
So will you give us an example?
I'll tell you an example where I was hesitating to pitch for 100 gigawatts of solar power. I was very hesitant that, you know, if you want me to go from 20 gigs by 2022, which was the target which I inherited, to 100 gigawatts, 1 lakh megawatts, it's going to be very difficult to get the transmission in place and very expensive. And he said, Piyush, tum jara socho na, or alternate socho, aap give up thodi kar sakte. And he just off the cuff, he said, maybe you could look at hybrids in a bigger way. Think of solar wind hybrids. Imagine this transmission cost is a one-time cost you're incurring today. You'll get solar power, wind power for generations after that. So look at the big picture. Don't be myopic in your thinking. And I thought that was really something which was a learning for me.
Because in India, otherwise we love incrementalism. In India, we always plan for shortages. Ke pehle two-lane road banao, jab tak wo banega, four-lane full ho jayega, phir four-lane banao, phir.
You know, if you'll see his slogan before we came into government, he always talked about speed, skill, and scale. And if you see every program of this government, we've focused on these three. And on the back of these three, we've been able to get a lot of value propositions for the nation. Today, solar power is down 40% from what it was barely 2 years ago.
Down means price is down.
Prices.
Not
quantity,
production.
Volumes are about 10x.
Right.
Or what's happening right now. In terms of LED bulbs, we inherited a system where the price of the government purchase was 310 rupees for a 7-watt bulb, and the government company used to do 600,000 bulbs in a year. Today, as we speak, the same government company run by government employees is doing 700,000 bulbs every day, from 600,000 a year to 700,000 a day. That's the kind of growth. And by the way, prices are down from 310 for a 7-watt bulb to 54 rupees 90 paisa for a 9-watt bulb, 30% more illumination at 17% of the original price. So economies of scale come in. Transparency and honesty help us cut the flap. A little bit of innovative financing. So earlier, just because a lot of finance experts here, and Shekhar Bhai, you understand economy and economics. The LED bulbs used to be paid over 5 years. Who the hell is going to trust government with their money for 5 years? So we said on 30th day, you'll get money in your bank through an RTGS transfer. I'm told just that one change has reduced the cost by about 40 or 50 rupees. Just that one change. And I think the next contract or tender, we're going to make it 7-day payment.
In fact, I keep telling him that looks like half of those bulbs have been bought by Mamata Banerjee in Kolkata. Because if you go to Kolkata, you see everything covered in those blue and white bulbs. Because that's chosen color for the city. What are the failures yet?
Well, I think one big challenge before all of us as we go forward is the last mile delivery, to make sure that whatever we are doing really reaches the man at the bottom of the pyramid. We were really in a hurry, and we built up expectations beyond a reasonable level, where we now realize that ultimately to reach the last man, we'll have to go through a process, a system, where the center can set policy, can set vision, can fund, but we'll have to be dependent on the state government, and from the state down to the panchayats or the municipalities and corporations. And that mindset change, which has to translate from Prime Minister Modi to his government, to the state government, down to the last officer who has to deliver results. I think that process is taking longer than one should. And in that, we hear a lot of stories. So you'll hear very often people complain that corruption has stopped at the top. Delhi corridors are out of dalals. But at the lower level, in the municipalities, the cops on the street, there we still have to look
the line man mindset change. In your business, the line man.
Yeah, in our business, the line man. But there, I think I have cracked the code on that. I'm trying to see how transparency can make that difference. So every action that we do, I don't wait for you to set up an RTI on me. I give it suo motu to the people of India. Every information, every action is made transparently available. The more and more we are making it transparent, I'm finding the avenues for somebody to create a problem are disappearing. The 80-20 principle works here also. My own submission to all of you is that out of the 100 crore people who enjoy the benefit of electricity in this country today, my sense is at least 80 or 85% don't consume more than 5-7% of the nation's power. It's that 15% top bracket and industry which consumes the larger amounts of power. Jo chori ki samasya, the problem of theft, is more in the foundries, in the businesses, where they find an economic value to steal power, and where the linesmen also can be paid off reasonably well,
right?
Because you save a large amount and you share a little bit. So, garib aadmi 100 rupaye bacha ke linesman ko kya?
Arbitrage is there.
There's a larger arbitrage. So we are now focusing to address that problem, again with the support of the state governments. So if a state government completely decides not to work with us in that, then we'll have to take some alternate measures. But I can assure the people of India through you, Shekhar Bhai, that come what may, whatever may be the difficulties or challenges, we are committed to ensuring 24/7 affordable power access to every citizen of this country, adequate power to the farmers, and both of these in a sustainable manner, particularly given the huge thrust we've given to renewable energy.
Piyush, your Uday scheme you've talked about often enough, so I'm not taking you into that. But basically what it means is that losses that state utilities have added up, and they've all gone bankrupt many times over, you are passing bulk of that burden to state governments in terms of bonds. And in the process, you're also getting banks to reduce interest rates to their base levels, etc., etc. Now, this solves one problem. It had to be done. The problem is of the current banking logjam and the current bankruptcy. But what does it do for the future? Because 3 years from now, these utilities will again be in the same state, and then state governments will be bankrupt.
Thank you. It's a lovely question, and I'm glad you asked, because in fact, I've come 2 or 3 times to Mumbai only to talk to the analysts and explain to them how Uday is different.
Aaj ki problem, agli sarkar ko to transfer nahi kar rahe.
So first of all, let me set the context right. Uday, the Ujjwal Discom Assurance Yojana, does not resolve only the problem of the past. It's probably the most comprehensive plan ever made to address the challenges of the power sector, which addresses the past accumulated muck, which draws up a roadmap, what we'll do in the next 4 years, and has a hard budget constraint for the people that these DISCOMs can never go in the red again in the future. And if they do go in the red, the states will have to fund it upfront. They can't pass it on to their subsidiary. And I'll give you an analogy. It's what were the DISCOMs? They were like a subsidiary of the holding company. The state government being the holding company, instead of parking these losses in their balance sheet, they conveniently created a DISCOM as a subsidiary, 100% owned by the state government, and did not right price power, did not reduce the inefficiency of the DISCOM, and just accumulated the debt in the DISCOM. Now, bankers always assume that a loan given to a DISCOM is a loan given to the parent company, the state government.
No.
So neither will anybody question us.
As my favorite writer P.G. O'Rourke says, it's like a triple B negative rated bond. It's like lending money to your younger brother. So this is money given to your younger brother. You don't expect it to come back.
That's what we've plucked. What we've done now is, for the past, we've said you've got to put in 75% of your accumulated debt into the state government's balance sheet, the holdco, the parent company's balance sheet. And for the balance also, the state government will have to guarantee the bond that the DISCOM can give for the residual 25%. And mind you, I have not asked banks to reduce their interest rates. Banks' interest rates are a function of the risk reward ratio.
It's a cabinet decision that they have to
lend at base rates. I'm sorry, Shekhar Bhai. It's not even a cabinet decision. The banks have a market mechanism. The bond pricing is determined by the market. And state government bonds have a certain market price. These bonds have all gone. I've given 1 lakh crores of bonds in March of this year. In 1 month, and the market lapped it up, but at market price. As far as the future is concerned, in the future, if they make a loss, I have provided that banks will not lend money to you. The state government will have to take it into their balance sheet or will have to guarantee a bond if the DISCOM is issuing the bond. So it's a very, very strong constraint on the states to incur any further losses.
So just when the conversation is warming up, we are taking a short break. We'll be right back, and that's when the audience also gets into the fray. Anybody wants to ask a question? Harsha. Harsha is an architect, Harsha Mehrotra.
This is regarding waste to energy. I had a problem in Bombay recently at Chembur, Devnar fire. And what are we doing concrete solution for this?
You're all aware that as soon as this government came in, one of our first programs was the Swachhata Abhiyan, Swachh Bharat. And I remember many people trying to belittle that program and trying to say that Prime Minister shouldn't be talking about clean India, about cleanliness. I think it was visionary of the Prime Minister to actually understand the huge dimensions that Swachhata has in our lives. It's not only about healthcare, it's not only about environment, it's actually about our mindset. And as far as waste to energy goes, it's a very obvious corollary that if we are going to be focused on cleaning up the nation, the streets, all the garbage, then we have to process that garbage. We can't let that just accumulate in landfills like it has happened for the last 7 decades. So one of the decisions we took in the government is that waste to energy and waste to compost are the two ways we can dispose of waste, and then there'll be only about 5-7% which goes into the landfill. The Power Ministry in its tariff policy has made it compulsory, mandatory, that whatever waste is converted to power will compulsorily be purchased by the state distribution company, and its cost will be socialized on the entire cost of purchase of power. So now, anywhere in the country, if anybody produces energy out of waste, we will compulsorily buy it from you at a cost plus reasonable return, which the state regulator will determine. Second, we realize that the second way to process it is to convert it into fertilizer. But sadly, the mindset is still not to use organic manure or fertilizer coming out of waste. So the cabinet took a decision, we now subsidize fertilizer coming out of waste by 1500 rupees a ton to encourage farmers to mix it with the regular urea, ammonia and all that. Because we actually found that this organic manure gives you very good product. If any of you is into farming, I'm told organic produce fetches a 3 or 4 times price compared to the regular agricultural products. So in that sense, both of these have been acted upon, and I would urge city governments across the nation to plan for processing waste. I've also, for that matter, in the power policy, brought in one more amendment that any wastewater which is treated and can be used in the thermal power plants will compulsorily be used to generate power, and the clean water which the power plants use can go and feed the cities. So that, these are the three major initiatives on waste that we've already done.
Question there?
Hello. My name is Harshavardhan Dole. I'm a power sector analyst. You very well explained that you have taken a lot of initiatives to turn around the sector, and we greatly appreciate that. What we are eager to know is the impact of higher supply of coal or you implementing the UDAY. When would visible results of these initiatives be seen?
Actually, if I may submit, Harshvardhan, we already are seeing some results, and a lot more results will happen day in and day out. But let me give you one example which I would urge all of you also to monitor. Look at an app which I have brought out called Vidyut Pravah. Pravah is the flow. Vidyut Pravah, electricity flow. Now, there was a time 2 years ago when there was always a country distressed with power shortages. With Vidyut Pravah, I brought into public domain. Every 15 minutes, the power exchange releases data of the price at which power is available in every state in the country. So right now, if you go on to Vidyut Pravah, I don't know what the time is right now.
It's 8:30 exactly.
So 8:30 to 8:45 in this band, at what price power is available anywhere in the country is available on that. And you'll be happy to know, all of you, that every moment of the day, 24 hours, there's power on the exchange. It's for states to buy at very reasonable costs. Gone are the days where, let's say, Tamil Nadu or Kerala, of course, I'm not saying that because the elections, it's over now, but gone are the days when they had to buy power in the sordid heat of, May.
Elections.
At 11, 12, 14 rupees, if anybody has been following or comes from the south. Today, South India enjoys power at 3, 4 rupees, 4 and a half, slightly more than North India. But an average power price never goes beyond $3. Any time of the day.
But you know,
that's because coal is sufficient, power is sufficient.
This has not settled every problem, because many state governments are still shy of billing and collecting. For example, my home state, Haryana, which is the richest state in India, it has 9-hour power cuts every day for rural domestic, not farmer, not agricultural, rural domestic. So power goes off at 6 in the morning, it comes at 1, it goes up at 3, then it again comes at...
By the way, that's my home state also.
Yes, comes at 6. So it tells you that the state government is not willing to bill and then collect these bills. So that problem is there.
I'd like to share the reality behind this. The Haryana government just came in about a year and a half ago.
And Haryana announced that they have surplus power, so they are willing to export
it. They do,
it.
And I'll explain it to you. The bigger problem in Haryana is the lack of adequate distribution infrastructure. The last mile connectivity to the Dhanis, the hamlets at the far-flung areas, which now we are addressing through the Dindyal Upadhyay Gram Jyoti Yojana, which the center is funding. But the Haryana problem is very peculiar. A, when Minister Manohar Lal came in as Chief Minister, he was saddled with 4,000-5,000 crores of annual loss, some 30,000 crores of accumulated loss, which was built up in the past. Now a new person comes in, he can't overnight change the situation. So he's working very closely with me, and I'm happy to inform you, Haryana will be the first state under UDAY, which from 5,000 crore loss will become a profit state by next year. It's doing really wonderful work. B, the reason for that problem is something which Prime Minister Modi cracked 12 years ago in Gujarat, and that was one of my first learnings after becoming minister. The reason those people don't get power is not because there is no power, because there is the same line which gives power to the farm and to the home.
So you have to separate feeders.
We needed separate feeders for the farms.
Which started with Gujarat, in fact.
So Gujarat, and you know, Prime Minister told me one day in a flight, we were coming.
Jyoti Gram scheme.
Yeah. When he first conceptualized that we should have a separate feeder line, farmers need power 8 to 10 hours, so that can work 8 to 10 hours. And the home can get 24 hours, which can be built. He said his own state, he was not able to sell that idea. So can you believe he had to get a cooperative bank to give a 6 crore rupee loan to experiment on this? Of course, then it's legendary. The success of that is something we are duplicating. Now I'm funding states to have separate feeders for rural areas and the domestic consumption or industrial consumption. Once that's done across the country, but again, I have to work through the states to implement
right,
it.
Right.
Once that's done, every home will have the benefit of 24/7.
And power is a very political subject. Electricity, other power is purely political, but question.
But it's very intoxicating also.
Intoxicating, right? Yes. Any question from Rajesh?
Piyush, can I just distract you a bit from power and ask you to wear your investment and banking hat? You were on the board of two huge public sector banks in the past. And where we are at this point of time...
Including State Bank, I think.
State Bank and BOB. Did this NPA crisis, was it not anticipated, or was it anticipated and the PSU banks decided not to do anything about them?
Well, I think, and I'm on record on this, if somebody was to look back into my statements before I became a minister, the PSU banks over many years worked under a lot of political pressure. That's one thing that Prime Minister has been successful in stopping. If you recall the Gyan Sangam in Pune, where he publicly announced that no politician will ever call a bank manager or a bank chairman. And from then till today, this government has not interfered in any working of the banks. We've left it to the regulator, RBI, and the banks. But that's an inherited legacy of large amounts of loans given under political pressure. And a lot is going to get revealed. The lot is coming to our notice now, which is shocking. How to help particular companies, the political establishment used to go out of the way. Some of the people in this audience also are personally aware of what used to happen. Second, in the past, the thinking was, give money today and you are going to retire in 2-3 years. And after that, it's somebody else's headache. But when that headache came to the forefront, the then incumbent would say, let me pass this on to the next guy. Let me somehow just cover the problem. And over the years, you had a situation where you only kept covering the mess, not letting it out. I think for a change, this government has allowed it to come out in the open. We're trying to resolve it permanently. But having said that, I must give the other side of the story also. Not all loans are bad. Not all promoters are culprits or cheats. There are many industries which have gone bad for reasons beyond the promoter's control. So if we had not brought in MIP, the minimum import price for steel, today India would have been 100% a steel importer and our entire industry would have collapsed. We would not have had any steel industry in India, probably 200,000 crores of bad debts. And then once these had collapsed, in the future, the people of India would have paid twice what they are paying now. Because then the foreign companies would have had a home run. So it's this government is sensitive to addressing these issues where it's not the promoter's fault. So we address these issues real time, very fast. The Indian
so basically we have to learn to accept business failure, genuine business failure.
But genuine business failures, this government will protect and support. But that's for them to demonstrate to the banks and for the banks to take a call in. The politicians won't interfere unless a policy change is required.
We are taking a short break. We'll be right back. Jamie, if you would also introduce yourself.
Jambon. Hi, Piyush.
Just also say what you do. I know everybody is on first name terms with Piyush.
I'm a business executive. Piyush, bringing you back to your portfolio, you know, you just touched upon open access. And I feel strongly that if you were able to make a breakthrough on open access, I don't know whether it will be a carrot and stick with Uday, but open access and net metering. I personally think would make a huge difference in empowering the consumer.
He wants Uberization of power, so everybody can produce his power and sell.
Well, I'll be very upfront with you. It's good that Jamie has raised that question. And I think it's good that we all understand the challenge before open access. Now, how do we run a state electricity company? After all, the farmers of this country deserve some support. And you know how stressed the Indian farming sector is. Most of them dependent on monsoon and benevolence of nature. Very small land holdings, very poor recovery of their produce. Years of distress, last 3 years have been distraughtful for them. Now in this situation, I'm sure all of you will agree that that little subsidy given to them, what it doesn't really pinch any of the business or any of the industry. So I think giving that subsidy is important to empower them. And that is cross-subsidized by the business, by industry, by commercial users. Moment we make open access more easy, the high-paying customers start going in for cheaper sources of direct access for power, and the state boards will not be able to support the poor farmers, the poor of India. So I think rather than focusing on how to make open access happen, my job, and which I am trying to do, is to make the entire power cost come down. Make sure everybody gets coal, so you don't have to spend $20 billion importing coal. Save that money there. Make sure that the theft of people in business and high places is stopped so that we can cut down the AT&C losses. Make sure that we bring energy efficiency in big measure so that we can reduce the electricity bills of the consumers. My focus is on that end. And I think rather than open access, I'll make everybody get cheaper power, both the farmers, the poor, and industry. For example, I've suggested to Madhya Pradesh to look at an alternate proposition, and I'm willing to support any state which does that, that to encourage the Make in India program, why can we not give power at a very low and affordable price for 10 years? So I'm happy to say, okay, at $4 a unit, I'll give power for the next 10 years, come and invest in India, make in India, make India an energy, make in India a powerhouse in manufacturing. So we are looking at those kind of out-of-the-box ideas rather than trying to beat around the same old theories which will never see the light of day. We'll only keep, let's say, arguing on talk shows, but we'll never achieve something. So I believe in practical result rather than intellectual concepts.
Piyush, if I can take you back to the financial sector since we're in Mumbai. The FM did make a statement that the government, the finance ministry, has a mature relationship with the RBI and the governor. And yet today we witnessed what I can only call a full frontal personal and intellectual attack on the governor by a member who's generally and somewhat vaguely associated to have a friendly disposition towards your government.
And this he's a member of his party.
And now he's a member of our party.
Yeah, he's a member of your party and Rajya Sabha nominee.
That's
and so
right.
On. And yet, this has happened at a time when 100% of people polled today in Mumbai said the RBI and governor have done an excellent job in terms of both monetary policy.
Everybody has their own
monetary
opinions.
Policy as well as actually managing inflation.
Leo, I get your point, but
it was adverse.
This is a democracy. Everybody has their own opinions.
Yes.
And we allow everybody to give their opinions. And the culmination of all those opinions is what helps us make a good policy. So you may have a point of view that is very intelligent and done an excellent job. Somebody else may have a different point of view.
No, but is
just
this
like
a mature...
you cannot force your view on him, he's not forcing
fair
his
enough.
View.
But the point is about the maturity and the tonality of the discussion and the question.
Well,
is,
by the way,
that
gentleman was
is
a professor
helpful?
At Harvard and at IIT Delhi. So I would not suspect his maturity. And his years of experience are more than the... much more than any of us in this room. So maturity is a matter of opinion.
But do you have
an opinion about a certain person in a certain
But do you have agreement with
he
his
has
view?
A different
do you have are you persuaded to his
I
view?
I've not been asked about that view. I'll give it to my bosses if they ask me my view.
No, I'm asking, I'm not your boss, but I'm doing this conversation with you. I'm asking you because you know his views.
Well, that sector doesn't report to me, so I don't need to necessarily have a view on that sector.
See, that's what happens when people come to Delhi. They immediately become Delhi Wallahs.
If I may just add, this whole Uday scheme actually got started and has largely drawn from that was written by the Reserve Bank of India to the Honorable Finance Minister and to the various states. And that is what kick-started the entire Uday scheme and has largely focused on addressing the concerns that Reserve Bank had raised. But I don't know now why there's a change of mind and that now they don't find Uday all that hot. So that's something you all may like to consider about the abilities of different people to understand good government policy.
We are taking a short break. We'll be right back. Arpita, you have the last question. Arpita is a PhD scholar at IIT Bombay.
I would actually want to ask you a question about opening up coal mining for private players. And how do you seek environmental accountability in the process of coal mining? Because as in when competition goes up, it's going to get more aggressive. And the more aggressive it gets, technology coming in, there would be more open mining, more depletion of water table, but thereby leading to more drying up of farmlands. So how do you take that into account?
You know, there's a lot of Western propaganda against coal. So let's first of all recognize that coal is needed in India, will continue to be the mainstay of our power needs. And just so that everybody understands the right perspective, our consumption of coal today in 2016 in India is the same level that the United States of America was consuming in 1865, just about 150 years ago on a per capita basis. So we are not the guys who are responsible for this problem. The greenhouse gases are because of the United States, because of Australia. I'll come to your question. Because of Europe. I wanted to take this opportunity
China.
To give these details to everybody. 50% of the greenhouse gases are by the population supporting 10-12% of the people of the world. India supporting 17% has only added 2-2.5% of the greenhouse gas. We need development space, so we will need coal. But Prime Minister Modi's government is very conscious that while we need coal, we'll do it efficiently, we'll do it in an environment-friendly manner. I'd like to share with you, next week, I'm at MIT. My team, of course, will be there before me, 3 days before me. I've already had one round with MIT professors to partner with MIT to bring clean coal technologies to India and to do research. And we are going to fund it. Have you ever heard India funding research in the United States? Because we need clean coal. We want to make sure coal mining is done efficiently. Coal is processed. And you'll be happy to know today not 1 kilo of coal goes out of the mine without being crushed. You'll be happy to know we are investing deeply in coal washing facilities. So by next year end, we will have about 15 new washeries, something which was not done in 70 years. We are planning to do in 18 months. 15 new washeries in the coal mines. And I've made a commitment that no coal which goes beyond 500 kilometers will have fly ash more than 34%, which is the environmental norm. We are investing deeply to get clean coal into India, to process coal, to convert coal to gas. We have a lot of shortage of gas in this country. It's a more efficient way to use coal. So I can assure you and assure the people of India, while we will need coal, we'll do it efficiently, we'll damage the environment as less as we can. But we need that to give affordable power to the poor of India, to give affordable power to the farmers of India, to keep power for the industrialists sitting here at reasonable prices so that they don't lose their competitive edge when they have to compete in the world.
Well, thank you very much, Piyush. We can go on, but we have to let you go. So thank you very much. It's been a wonderful conversation. Thank you very much for watching. We've had an exciting conversation. We'll be back with you with our next edition of Off the Cuff or OTC with an equally interesting and lively guest. Although after Piyush Goyal, that will be a tough act to follow.